Okay, this three-dimensional map, if I can get it to show, it can be quite useful. There's Kalama, just about in the center left. That's the city you fly in, fly out of when you're going to San Pedro de Atacama, which is right beneath it and to the right where the black arrow is. Notice the red broken line defining where Bolivia is and where Argentina is. Now again, to the left is where I was on the first tour. The second tour was the Salar de Atacama. And you'll notice that there's a ridge to the left of the valley where the red road runs through it. And that's the Domecki mountain range. That's about, I think, 70 million years old. And then Valle de Luna, the Valley of the Moon, is that area right in there, dead centered, where we walked down the giant sand dune. And then later on, went up somewhere there to get a picture of the sunset, which didn't occur on the sunset. Okay, a different vantage point and a different three-dimensional map. Atacama to the left of the Salar. And then below us here is where the Valle de Luna was, or is. And then we went into the white area, that's the Salar and the Salt Lake. And then on up above here, I'll try to focus down to it. Is Socari up there at 4,200 meters is where the Tatio geyser field is. And here's an even better view of the Luna de Valle, Valle de Luna. It would be in between these two cordilleras and up to the left here. The Salar de Atacama, of course, at the top, and Atacama, San Pedro de Atacama would be over here to the left. A maytat in the form of a stone, although it looks more like a grinding hole than the classic maytat. This is a grinding hole in a stone. Normally you associate stones as maytats and grinding holes being in a solid chunk of rock lying on the ground. Notice the fine detail of those points and the use of obsidian. One would think you'd find obsidian with this phenomenal Andes, which is almost totally volcanic. And that's a rather small and discreet, and I associate small with high-tech fire starting piece of wood. Bowls and their designs. It's hard to get a decent picture with this glass. This cabinet is illustrating bones used. This, of course, is some kind of an awl, I would suggest. The next are skulls of a male, and then a female, and a niño, a child, from 12,000 years ago. Be interesting to look at, which is what scientists do, the skulls of other humans throughout the world. Okay, the museum is laid out in radiating arms, if you will, from the center point. This is first just a generalization of the area. And this next one is the earliest of hunters. And then these were the later group of hunters, advanced hunters. And then this deals with the pastoral and agricultural phase. And then this was the influence of the culture of the Tuanaca in the oasis area here, specifically here. And then this last deals with the influence on these cultures of the Inca and of the Spanish. So this first arm deals with the first hunters around 11 to 8,000 BP, although the guides will give different time periods going up to as high as 13,000 years ago. Now this drawing suggests that at the time of 12,000 years ago, the mastodons and other huge herbivorous animals existed. But the literature is suggesting that, in fact, the only things that existed here were the camelids and some ground burrowing animals and so forth that the hunters and gatherers took advantage of. It is important that at the time, the rainfall was twice what it is today. The temperature was colder, but it was also more humid. And they say that this had no effect on the plant life except to increase its abundance. A different kind of fauna did not exist. The weapons of the periods were darts thrown by hand, darts here meaning arrows, or with the use of the atlatl, which increased the power or the distance by 3 times. This core and the chips off of it are a little bit different to me, because while I'm sure they're volcanic and probably quite hard, they don't appear to have the sharpness of or the strength of obsidian or of chert or flint or something like that. And a classic example of how these toolkits were made, and they were made the same way, I think, throughout the world. Whether that's a product of spontaneous knowledge or of the spreading of knowledge over great vast amounts of time. I'll scan through these pictures fairly quickly and rapidly. This shows uses and techniques for creating the stone tools. Here using wood. I had not seen this technique before, where they take a thin slab, almost like a rough knife blade, and hitting it on its edge, it creates sharp points. I hadn't seen that. Certainly the knives were extremely useful for dressing out an animal and for making the clothes. Here's another example, apparently, in the refinement in the making of these tools, perhaps in making them thinner, more knife-like, stiletto-like, we know them, thinner as to thickness, as well as perhaps width. I think the next series of videos will show increasing degrees of the quality and sophistication of the toolkit. Here, for example, rather heavy, blunt instruments, probably for breaking bones, scraping hides. Here a much greater refinement, and still yet somewhat rough. Even the obsidian one, they're kind of rough. Quite thick, like this one on the left. Thick as to thickness rather than width. Here showing a little bit smaller ones. Thinner as to thickness, a little more refined, still kind of rough looking if you look at this one here. Here, somewhat rough but much smaller, indicating, a smaller use of them on arrows, for example, which couldn't tolerate heavy weight, as opposed to spears. This will get two things from one, the multiplicity of materials available, 7 here, and a certain refinement in the quality. For example, the red one to the third down and the middle one are much more refined. A curious diamond-shaped one here, a little bit more refined. In this section will be the late archaic hunters, 8,000 to 3,000 BP. I'm just guessing what the Spanish says, but I'm thinking it may be a tool sharpener, like an arrowhead. This mortar, if you will, symbolizes some of the significant changes that took place during this transitionary period to the third one we'll go to, dealing solely with pastoral and agriculture. It was during this particular period that, first of all, the weather got drier, and therefore it was easier and more necessary and viable to domesticate the llama, which that they did, even though they became more sedentary because they could do that. They began to cultivate some limited crops, they still moved or went to the different places they'd gone before as hunter-gatherers, but returning essentially to their residence. But the structures are not terribly surprising. What you can see, the sticking out probably the tree, some kind of tree limbs that they found, but it looks like the wood is some kind of the cactus. Sheets of cactus may be straightened out, flattened out somehow and able to be used, maybe even skins. And these are petroglyphs that have been extracted from the nature and brought here. Looks like some kind of a human, at least some kind of artsy reflection of one, but this looks like it is some kind of a human figure there. I don't know what this reflects. It's too bad they don't have a little hand art design. It may be some kind of net that was made for trapping the animals. I can't tell. Don't know the line. A sedentary life produces different kinds of implements, such as bowls and ceramic pottery, because you don't have to carry it anywhere. You can spend time hanging around someplace using these things. Early fabrics. Here, illustrating that from the Yama come the weaved garment or materials, the raising of corn or maize here, pottery. Here, the classic grinding device, the maitat. Here, the simulation of the burial context for the mummies. This may well be reflecting that some mummies have been left in their in situ and undisturbed. Notice here the implements, pots and so forth, perhaps like even the Egyptians several thousand years later had in their tombs the necessary foods and so forth and implements with which to live in this next life. That is a war club there, so certainly this would be a man. Underneath the material is the desiccated remains. In general, what this is saying is that around this period of time, 1500 to 1000 years BP, the Tiwanaku state was developed near Lake Titicaca Pool of Bolivia. And it became the ceremonial and administrative center, one of the first states in South America. It then forced its influence throughout the Andean world, including southern Peru, parts of Bolivia, northwest Argentina, and northern Chile. This influence was both political, social, utilitarian, and religious. Politically, caciques, C-A-C-I-Q-U-E-S, local chiefs were under the control of Tiwanaku chief. Possessing objects from Tiwanaku was considered to be prestige and high status, and they reflected in their design the divinities, two of which were an individual of a hybrid bird, hybrid human and bird, or feline character, and then the second was sacrificador, which was the sacrificer with an axe in one hand, a decapitated head in the other. Interestingly, the introduction of bronze, gold, copper, and tin was introduced by the Tiwanakans. Around AD 1000, the Tiwanaku civilization collapsed, as did the pan-regional network that had been created. This shows Tiwanaku in the upper right with the arrow and its directions of influence. Elaborately designed and painted. It looks almost like a serpent. These were tablets used for the inhalation of hallucinogenics like cocaine. See, this lower part held the cocaine, then with a hollow tube or reed it was sucked up. Now this was considered a religious experience, so the design at the top was probably the most important part of this device. More of these devices, more elaborate. Maybe a leopard. Here on the right, I think, is a pictorial diagram of what we're looking at. Although, frankly, it doesn't look the same. But at any rate, this is a fabric. You can imagine when the colors were fresh and bright and complete. A very clever artistic skill to put a what would be perceived as a flat on the right, but to inscribe it on a round surface. A gold cup, or at least gold covered. Notice the fineness of the arrowhead, the dart in the front. This is a major shaft. And then the bow, the introduction of the bow was an important weapon increase and allowed for that smaller, demanded that smaller arrowhead. This bell symbolizes the influence of the Spanish and the Incas. During the 5 centuries before the invasion of the Spanish, this culture reached its ultimate and autonomous pre-Columbian manifestations. The Incas imposed, either peacefully or violently, their entire culture, including their religion, a solar cult, and veneration of the Inca emperor. Culture and social changes, customs, objects, social organization, economics, production organization, payment of tribute to the state, technologies, increase in mining activities, politics, Inca authority, centralized power of the empire, and infrastructural administrative sanctuaries in the Inca Road. 90 years after the arrival of the Incas, the Spanish invaded, solidifying their control in 1540 AD with the conquest of Pucara de Quitor, a fort that I'll try and visit here soon. Spanish colonization resulted in biological as well as cultural mixing. Christianity imposed, of course, and imposed, for example, burying the dead in a flattened position rather than in the flex burials. Spanish languages imposed. But there were new materials, wheat, beans, etc., animals, cows, sheep, goats, and horses were introduced. Industrial metals, production of iron, use of money, and in manufacturing. These were agricultural tools representing the Tiwanaku culture, but the introduction of these tools were Inca and Spanish. It looks like a metal cup of some sort, and a copper plate maybe back there. Of course, that's a fire starter kit. I don't know what this kit is here, but it has that tool with the round disc on it. It has hide, and it's all wrapped together. Products from the Incas. Snuff. Plus the little spoons and used. That should be familiar to any modern-day drugger. I don't know if these are fire-starting devices, these tools, or whether they're for weaving. They look like they'd be weaving things. This is a map of Imperial Inca, showing the San Pedro de Atacama down lower right. Some elegant vessels. Inca vessels. You wonder how they were supposed to be used or how they were used with that pointed, what looks like a bottom. There being the opening at what we presume to be the top. These are Inca and perhaps reflect the influence of their skill with very fine, small arrowheads. Of course, here the impact of the Spanish. Their religion, Catholic, still a heavy influence. And the sword. If that doesn't epitomize the Spanish, I don't know what it does. The sword and the Bible. With this bellows also reflects the introduction of iron and other metals of that nature and their manufacturing use and products. Back at this section, since the people have moved out of the way so I can record, some of the products that they use. Looks like some kind of nut. Calabaza, a gourd, a squash. Quinoa still used here. Still can get it in foods in almost any of the restaurants. And this algarrobo, coming from that big tree of which I took a picture, I think down in the canyon, Jerry, J-E-R-E. It's the one that the seeds inside are sweet. It can be made into an alcohol. And children, when they're teething, are given it. This is Rica Rica, which I saw in the green form. And it can be used for stomach problems. So it's an herb. Apparently, either a real or reproduction of grave findings. That looks, if that's the case, that would still be desiccated skin on the what looks like a rib cage. Presumably that's the human skull. Here a petroglyph carved into a chunk of stone, reflecting probably either the Yama or the Vicuna, probably a Vicuna. Number four, pastoralist agriculturist. This was the time of the pinnacle of time of pastoralism and ultimately of agriculture, as well as the evolution of sedentary life into community organizations, etc. And it was in the oases of which San Pedro de Atacama is one that these communities were developed for the obvious reason of water, and productivity of agricultural. Monochrome or ceramic forms dominated, first by red forms, then by black forms, each of which had a human face on them, it seemed, and some of the vessels were incised. In other words, they weren't painted, they actually made a mark in them. Basket weaving became important. Apparently during this period, a strong association between hallucinogenic drugs and religious beliefs and social activities. Presumably prior to this, the ones we saw were just for fun. Clay pipes for tobacco and ultimately hallucinogenics. Points out that in this period of time there was a great deal of trade around itself. A burial pot. You look at something and realize you're looking at a person who had a life, dreams, calamities, hopes. And that most of what he was physically and mentally was me, human. He was not that distant. Some examples of products of the time, beans, salt on the right, four different apparently kinds of maize or corn, maybe even more so with those small ones, whatever they were. Here are the vessels. Well, they're kind of unique in that here there's a whole bunch of holes. Could this have been used for watering plants or gardens? And some kind of human face here again. The lighting is so goddamn bad in here you can't see much. here holes around the top. Would they have been to attach a cover? And here just a regular bowl again. The human face, the mouth, an obvious hole, but it doesn't go all the way through like the prior two pots. Big pots and a smoking pipe, rather large pipe I might add. Beautiful display of the tiny arrowheads, including that one in the corner. On the left, about the size of, a little bit larger than a quarter's diameter. Ones in the lower right maybe being maximum, that long one of a quarter's diameter. But the one in the upper left-hand corner being closer to a dime's diameter. Used on these kind of implements. And here an example of a human with the arrow still stuck in his head, in his jaw, whether he was killed and it was left in there, or he lived and they just left it in there as a badge of something or other, who knows. When I look at it closer with my glasses, there is some material, looks like if it's bone material grown on the top of that arrowhead, then it indicates this person lived with that artifact in his jaw or her jaw. Weapons, war club with a rock, fairly substantial stick here with that round circular club thing on the end. Notice the knob to prevent it from falling off. Here, axes, axe, stone axe heads attached to their handle. Here are the black ceramics with the face representations. Sometimes they're graphic like that. Sometimes they sculpted into a face form, indicating that metallurgy allowed them to replace the same design weapon devices with metal instead of the stone. My guess is that this is either a deadly weapon or for catching fish. I'm guessing that the two broad metal arms are the part that are the weapon, and the pointy part what goes inside of a piece of wood or something to hold it. Interesting how war and vice have their own art. Going to enter the room of gold art, I think. Notice this clever door. I'm assuming this was found in situ with this, what looks like an infant. That was used for the ear. Or the nose. Since there are two of them, perhaps they're earrings. Maybe those are earplugs. Rings. Nose or earplugs. Gold goblets. Notice with the face, probably representing the emperor, some god. These look like copper rather than gold. So this shows how they might have been used as a necklace, perhaps. I don't know. Again, don't know what the use of these were. It's the Universidad Católica del Norte, and then it's the museum. I cannot avoid the cynicism of the Catholic Church being having itself in first place twice as big as the actual museum, which is the reason we're here. As maintained as you can see from that one.
And then new high-rises, apartments are off.